Hello, this is Dr. João Flávio Nogueira from Brazil, and we are going to demonstrate to show an endoscopic middle ear dissection that we performed on Barcelona in February 2018. So the first step is to clean the ear canal to expose the tympanic membrane. This is a left ear. As you can see, this is anterior, posterior, superior, and inferior. This is the malleus here. And the first step is to create actually the tympanometal flap. The tympanometal flap, actually during surgery, is the procedure that it seems to be the most challenging, since it's the procedure that bleeds more. So we tend to do incisions that will vary accordingly to the disease of the patient. In this case here, since it's a dissection and it's like a cholesteatoma, we would like to demonstrate a big tympanometal flap. I mean as anterior tympanometal flap. So we go here, this is the surgical position. This is 12 hours, 6 hours, 9 hours, and 3 hours. We go here 12 hours, we do our first incision. And then, instead of going to 11 or 12, 1 or 12 hours, we go here anterior to 11 hours to do this anterior flap. Why? To expose a little bit better this anterior part, to see the anterior malleolar ligament, the supratubal recess, to see the canal of the muscle, of the tensor tympani muscle. So we do this big flap here, this another incision here, and then we connect the two incisions using this Rosen knife. How about the length? How big should be the tympanometal flap during real surgery or real life? We tend to see there is a Rosen knife. We tend to use the Rosen knife as a measurement device. So we use two Rosen knives, one here, to create this tympanometal flap. And then we elevate the tympanometal flap. Of course, this is a cadaver, so we don't have any problems with bleeding. But we can demonstrate the use of a cotonoid. In real life, we use adrenaline, pure adrenaline-soaked cotonoids to help elevate this tympanometal flap. But in this case, we can just elevate the tympanometal flap. And as you notice, we did not infiltrate anything, even saline solution in this case here. Of course, it's a cadaver. In real life, you can infiltrate, if you want, saline solution or anesthetic solution with adrenaline. You can use other types of instruments, such as an electrical cautery with a very low setting in order to mark the incisions, to reduce the bleeding. Or you have different types of instruments, such as a round knife suction device. Many companies make those instruments nowadays, and then you can use those instruments in order to try to elevate with the less bleeding possible, because you have one hand with the instruments and the other hand you're holding the endoscope. Or also, if you have a holder, you can use this holder and then you have two hands. Also, if you have a good assistant with you, you can ask the assistant to hold the endoscope or to hold the suction, and then also you have two hands in a technique that is different from the technique that we are demonstrating now, with just one hand holding the endoscope and the other hand holding the instrument. So we elevate this superior part here, tends to be the part with more difficulties because it has more tissue here. This inferior part is usually very, very thin. The skin is very thin, so you have to be careful also not to tear the tympanometal flap. Of course, when you have disease, when you have inflammation inside, even if this inflammation is preoperatively treated by antibiotics, by anti-inflammatory medications, usually you do have a little bit of inflammation. And with this inflammation, you do have a little bit of edema, and sometimes with an inflamed tissue, it's going to bleed more, but the skin is going to be a little bit thicker than in a non-inflamed ear. For instance, sometimes when you operate an ear with a tympanic perforation or a chronic otitis, suppurative otitis media or a cholesteatoma, the skin flap usually is thicker than when you operate a case of otosclerosis, for instance, when you do not have any inflammation in the ear, in the middle ear, of course. So we elevate the flap, and this is a very nice thing about the endoscopes. First, you can teach very well the residents or the doctors that you're teaching the limitations and the anatomical landmarks that you have to use here, such as the annulus. So you can see very well the structures that you are working on it. And secondly, it's very, very intuitive and it's very, very easy to understand the anatomy when using the endoscope, because the endoscope, they have an image property, which is the fisheye lens, the wide angle view. It's like a GoPro camera or any other camera with this type of lens, that you can have a different image. Even with a 0 degree, you can have different images, even angle images of structures that otherwise a straight light will not be able to see. So we elevated here the tympanometal flap. This is the suture here, the region of the suture here. The region of the annulus is going to be seen in a bit here as we progress towards this elevation of the tympanometal flap. And here we can demonstrate the use of a cottonoid or use of a cotton ball. In real life, we put adrenaline-soaked, pure adrenaline-soaked cotton balls in order to do this elevation of this tympanometal flap. These adrenaline-soaked cottonoids are very nice because, first of all, they have adrenaline, so it's a very powerful vasoconstriction with a very low systemic absorption. The absorption is going to be more topic, more in the local, so you do not have many variations in the blood pressure and many variations in the heart rate of the patient when you use those topic pure adrenaline-soaked cottonoids. And secondly, you can use the suction in order to understand, and you can use actually the cottonoid as an adjunct for your dissection. You can push the cottonoids in order to help you in your dissection. So now we can see here the region of the annulus, and then we can elevate the region of the annulus here to try to understand the position of the annulus or the annulus canal and to see the mucosa of the middle ear. This is the chorda tympani nerve that we can see in the transparency. The annulus is going to be in this position here. And then we can elevate the annulus. We are elevating the annulus. And then the chorda is here by transparency. And then when you elevate the annulus, you expose this thin mucosa of the middle ear. And then you can go inside this thin mucosa, of course. In this posterior superior quadrant here, you have the ossicular chain. So you have to be careful in order not to injure the ossicular chain. So you go a little bit more here, more behind. So the chorda tympani is here, the annulus, the tympanic annulus is here. And here, the suture is here. Now we can see the suture in a very good way. And then when you elevate here, you can understand and you can see the mucosa, this thin mucosa of the middle ear, and then you can go in this inferior position towards the round window region, and then you elevate, and then you tear this middle ear mucosa, very thin middle ear mucosa, in order to expose the middle ear. And then with an instrument, you can go down here to elevate the tympanometal flap in this position to gain space. So we have the chorda tympani, tympanometal flap, round window niche here, round window region here with the anterior pillar, the posterior pillar, and the tegmen of the round window niche. You have here the promontory of the cochlea, the tympanic annulus here, the chorda tympani is here, and then you can tear again this mucosa in order to expose a little bit more the middle ear, especially the region of the ossicular chain. This is the region of the ossicular chain. We can see here the long process of the incus, the stapes here, the articulation between the incus and the stapes, and the stapedius tendon. Facial nerve is going to be here in this position here. So you have to be careful about the ossicular chain, not to injure the ossicular chain. Exposing a little bit more, you see the posterior malleolar spine and then the posterior malleolar ligament, which is here. Then we are going to tear apart this posterior malleolar ligament, which is a very thin ligament and attaches to the malleus in a position that is inferior to the superior malleolar ligament that's going to be in this position here. So we elevate here and we remove this posterior malleolar ligament. It's a very thin ligament. And then once we do this, we expose a little bit better the incus. Completely the long process of the incus, we can expose in a good way this position. And then we can see also a little bit of the malleus here, which is going to be very important for us to detach the tympanum metal flap from the malleus in order to have a very good anterior visualization of the middle ear cavity. So we have the tympanum metal flap, the posterior malleolar spine here, the posterior malleolar ligament that was here between the posterior malleolar spine and the malleus here. You have here the long process of the incus, stapes here, stapedius tendon here. And then we can see I just elevated a tympanum metal flap. I did not curette anything yet, and I did not drill anything yet. Just with the properties, the wide angle view of the endoscope, we could see a lot of the anatomy of the middle ear just elevating a tympanum metal flap. So we see the anterior pillar, posterior pillar, tegmen, the round window niche here, the fustis is going to be here between the anterior pillar and the posterior pillar. You have the sinus subtympanicum. And then we're going to elevate the tympanum metal flap from the malleus. So in a real life, it's actually easier than in a cadaver because the tissues are fresher. So we expose this region here of the malleus, and then we can elevate this tympanum metal flap without tearing the tympanic membrane. So we elevate the tympanum metal flap from this region of the malleus, and then with a pick or with some other instruments like a knife, we can elevate the tympanum metal flap without tearing this tympanum metal flap. So here you have the region of the anterior malleolar ligament. Look, the posterior malleolar ligament was in this region. The anterior one is a little bit more superior, a little bit more higher, and it's thicker, it's more white, and it's bigger, the anterior malleolar ligament. The posterior is smaller, very, very thin, and a little bit more like a muscle, more reddish. So we elevate with a cup forceps this tympanum metal flap. We expose here the entrance of the Prusak space, which is going to be in this position here. And also we expose this region here of the supratubal recess. So we elevate the tympanum metal flap from here. We can elevate more to completely elevate this tympanum metal flap, including from the ambus of the malleus, which is the most difficult region in order to elevate this, because here the tympanic membrane is more attached to it. So we elevate here this position from the ambus, and now we can see the malleus, we can see the incus, the long process of the incus, we can see the stapes, we can see the neck of the malleus here, and the head of the malleus is going to be here. These are some ligaments of the tympanic eptympanic diaphragm that supports here both the malleus and the incus. This is the entrance of the Prusak space. This is the anterior malleolar ligament that comes from the anterior malleolar spine to the malleus. The posterior malleolar ligament would be here, so this is more superior than here. And here we have the supratubal recess, the canal of the muscle, the tensor tympani muscle, that's going to be here. The corda is here. Stapes with the posterior crus and anterior crura that you're going to be seeing here in a bit. And then we can use a Bellucci scissor in order to try to cut this or in order to try to elevate this region from the ambus here. So you have almost a 360 degree view of the anatomy of the middle ear using this kind of approach, which is a very nice. And then you can elevate with a pick or with a knife the complete the tympanic membrane from the ambus, detaching the tympanic membrane from the ambus, and then having a more free region to understand and to see the anatomy. So the cochleariform process is going to be here. Tensor tympani tendon is going to be here. This is the canal of the muscle. This is not the facial nerve. Supratubal recess, and this is the facial nerve going down here below the long process of the incus. So cochleariform process, this is the eptympanic diaphragm ligaments, Prusak space opening here, anterior malleolar ligament, and the Eustachian tube is going to be in a position down, more down here. So you can see once again the anterior malleolar ligament, which is very, very different from the posterior malleolar ligament, which is very, very nice to understand this anatomy. And it's very easy to see using an endoscope in order to understand. So supratubal recess, cochleariform process here. This is the tensor tympani tendon, facial nerve. The tympanic segment of the facial nerve is going to be here. Lateral semicircular canal, we're going to see in a bit. Oval window niche, oval window region here. Tympanic segment of the facial nerve. And here you have the tympanic isthmus. In this case, the tympanic isthmus has a little bit of web, but it's open. The tympanic isthmus is open. Tympanic isthmus is the main ventilation route between the middle ear and the mastoid. So it's a region between the cochleariform process and the incudiostapedial joint. So here we are opening here the tympanic isthmus, just in order to see a little bit better this anatomy of the tympanic isthmus. This is the facial nerve, the tympanic segment of the facial nerve, and the lateral semicircular canal is going to be seen in a bit. Now, we understand that there are some webs here that can close this ventilation. Sometimes the ventilation is completely closed. When the ventilation is completely closed, the mastoid always has a small negative pressure. The Eustachian tube, when it opens, equalizes the system. When you have a tympanic isthmus closed, you don't have any way to equalize the pressure. So you can have a tympanic perforation, because it's a way that you can equalize the pressure, or you can have a retraction. And when you have a retraction, skin from the ear canal can go inside, and then you can have a retraction pocket cholesteatoma. So it's very important to understand. Another important thing is, where is the sinus tympani? The sinus tympani is this region here that we're using this instrument just in order to see. This is the pyramidoaminensis, this is the subpyramidal space, and this is the ponticulus. The ponticulus is a bone bridge, or can be a bone wall, between the subpyramidal space and the region of the posterior pillar. So this is the ponticulus. The region between the posterior pillar and the styloid proeminence, which is here, is called the subiculum. So ponticulus, subiculum, and between the ponticulus and the subiculum, we have the sinus tympani. So sinus tympani here, between the ponticulus and the subiculum. This is the posterior pillar. The anterior pillar is going to be more down here. And then you have the sinus tympani. The sinus tympani can vary in shape, in depth. And then you have the anterior pillar. The region between the anterior pillar and the jugular region is going to be called the funiculus. So you have the ponticulus, subiculum, funiculus. Between the ponticulus and subiculum, you have sinus tympani. Between the funiculus and the subiculum and funiculus, you have sinus subtympanicum. So sinus tympani here, sinus tympani in a very good way in order to understand, and sinus subtympanicum here between the subiculum and the funiculum, that's going to be down there. So ponticulus, subiculum, and down there we have the funiculus. Sinus tympani, sinus subtympanicum here in this region here. And you can work inside. We are using a 0-degree endoscope. You can work inside to understand, to see the depth of the sinus tympani and to see if there is any disease, especially when you have cholesteatoma. So you can see the depth of the sinus tympani, facial tympanic segment of the facial nerve, sinus subtympanicum here, round window niche, sinus subtympanicum. And then this region here, it's called in the books the posterior sinus. It was called the posterior sinus because when it was described using a posterior tympanotomy that would be here, it was posterior to the sinus tympani. But actually, the posterior sinus is anterior. So nowadays, we call this the anterior sinus. So we have anterior sinus, sinus tympani, sinus subtympanicum. And inside the sinus subtympanicum, we can have this structure here, which is called the fustes. That is a very nice structure that directs as is actually the floor of the Scala tympani. So when you have doubt, when you want to do a cochlear implant, for instance, and you want to do a round window insertion, you can use the fustis as a landmark, as a very reliable anatomic landmark for the round window region and for the floor of the tympanic scala. So facial nerve and facial recess is going to be in this position here. So facial recess here, sinus tympani here, anterior sinus that was formerly known as posterior sinus, and sinus subtympanicum down here. This is the oval window niche, this is the round window niche, sinus tympani, anterior sinus, tympanic segment of the facial nerve, facial recess down here. So now we are going to curette just a little bit, just to expose a little bit more this region. A curette, a very good curette and a very sharp curette, is a very important instrument in the tray of any ear surgeon, especially when you want to use also with the microscope, the endoscope. I like to say that we are not endoscopic surgeons, and I like to say that we are not microscopic surgeons. We are ear surgeons, or we are surgeons. If you use an endoscope or if you use a microscope, you are using an instrument. And sometimes the endoscope is going to be a better instrument when compared to the microscope in the middle ear. And sometimes the microscope is going to be a better instrument when compared to the endoscope in the mastoid. In order to perform safe and sound endoscopic ear surgery, it's paramount that you have a good microscopic background. And in order to perform a very nice microscopic ear surgery with low recurrences and very good results, it's also important to have a very good endoscopic knowledge, to use the endoscope as the primary instrument or as an adjunct instrument in order to perform ear surgeries, especially for inflammatory diseases such as cholesteatoma, such as the chronic otitis media. So it's very important for us nowadays to understand this concept of using the correct instrument to the most important region, which this instrument is going to be better than other instruments when compared to. So now we are going, we curetted a little bit here, just a little bit, and with this small curette that we did, we can see here now the lateral semicircular canal, tympanic segment of the facial nerve, and the lateral semicircular canal with some webs here. And then you can see the adductus ad antrum, and then if you angulate a little bit more, and if you remove the incus, we can see the mastoid antrum. So this is very important with a very low, very small bone removal, we just remove this chip here, we can see a lot. Now, in order to proceed with the dissection, this is a dissection, we are going to cut the chorda tympani to gain space and to remove the incus and to have more space here, since this is not a surgery, but it's a dissection demonstration. So we are removing the chorda tympani here. And after we remove the chorda tympani here, this alligator doesn't have any teeth. So we have to be very careful. So when you remove the chorda tympani here, we also can clean the external auditory canal. And as you can see, we didn't use any fancy instrument or any different type of instrument at this point, just a very good sharp curette. And of course the endoscope, which is a 3 millimeter endoscope and by diameter, and 14 centimeters endoscope by length. This endoscope is very important in order to perform endoscopic ear surgery. You can use the traditional sinuscopes, the 4 millimeters in diameter and 18 centimeters in length endoscopes, the same endoscopes that you use for sinus surgery, you can use on endoscopic ear surgery. But the 3 millimeter endoscopes, they have the same light capabilities, the same wide-angle views that you can have on the 4 millimeter endoscope, but with 1 millimeter less, which can drive the endoscope more inside the middle ear, and then you can see potentially more important structures. So we are curettin here, the region of the facial recess, and then you can expose also a little bit better the facial nerve here, the facial recess of facial nerve here, the region of the facial nerve in this position here, and the region of the facial recess also in that position over there. So it's very, very nice to understand this anatomy in a very good way, to understand the facial anatomy in a very, very nice way. Facial nerve here, lateral semicircular canal here, pyramidal eminence here, ponticulus, subiculum, finiculum, sinus subtympanicum, sinus tympani, facial recess here. So it's a very nice anatomy that you can see just curettin a little bit this tympanometal, this external auditory canal. So long process of the incus, this is the malleus, entrance of the Prusak space. And now we are going to remove the incus in order to expose a little bit better and to see better the anatomy of the superior parts and the anatomy of the also the antrum of the mastoid. So we remove the incus, we detach from the incus tapetum joint, and then we remove. You see now the long process of the incus, you see the short process of the incus, tympanic segment of the facial nerve, and this is the malleus, and then you remove the incus here in a very good way. It's very easy to remove the incus, and I think the incus is too big for us still. I think in like millions of years from now, the incus will be a little bit smaller in order to have more space here in the at the tympanic isthmus. The tympanic isthmus, which is the main ventilation route from the eustachian tube to the mastoid, is this region here between the incus tapetum joint and the cochleariform process, which is here. So the main ventilation route is this one. This is the posterior isthmus here, and then this is the anterior ventilation route that goes to the Prusak space. Sometimes you can have a tensor fold here closing this anterior ventilation route, so the ventilation to the Prusak space is going to be in a retrograde way. So lateral semicircular canal, adus ad antrum here, and if you angulate a little bit more, you can see actually the mastoid antrum, and if you use a more angulated endoscope, you can go all the way to the mastoid tip. And here you have the cochleariform process. The cochleariform process is a very nice and reliable anatomic landmark for some things. One is for the geniculate. The geniculate is a little bit more anterior, but it's a very nice anatomical landmark for the region of the geniculate. Second one for the cog. The cog is this region here, center of gravity of the temporal bone. And the other one is for the Jacobson nerve, which is here, down here in this position. So geniculate, the cochleariform process is a good anatomical landmark for the geniculate, for the Jacobson nerve, and for the cog. The cog sometimes divides the supratubal recess from the anterior tympanic space. And sometimes it divides the anterior tympanic space from the posterior tympanic space. I think in this case here, the cog here is separating the anterior tympanic space from the posterior tympanic space. So anterior tympanic, posterior tympanic, adus ad antrum, and antrum of the mastoid. So you have the cog here, center of gravity of the temporal bone, geniculate ganglion here, cochleariform process, and then Jacobson nerve going down in this position. So this is the tympanic segment of the facial nerve, lateral semicircular canal, oval window niche, and this is the cog. And this could also be confused as the cog. I think this is the cog because the anatomical landmark is the cochleariform process. So you go here from the cochleariform process until the most superior region, anterior tympanic space, posterior tympanic space. And between the cog and the cochleariform process, you can have the tensor fold. The tensor fold can be like this, like a more a vertical way, or can be like this, a more horizontal way. It depends on the saticus, the saccus anticus and the saccus posticus, on the strength of each saccus that goes in the embryological period. And then you can have a more vertical or more horizontal. This is the tensor fold. This is here the region of the anterior malleolar ligament. This is the head of the malleus. And then you can have this tensor fold here blocking this anterior ventilation between the supratubal recess and the Prusak space. So the tympanic isthmus here, between the cochleariform process and the incodustapedial joint, posterior isthmus and the anterior isthmus. And to see if it's open, we can use the curved instrument like this to open the tensor fold and to open this ventilation route that goes directly to the Prusak space. When the tensor fold is complete, is closed, it doesn't mean that you will have ear disease. It does mean that you have two ventilation routes instead of three. But the Prusak space can be ventilated in a retrograde way from the tympanic isthmus. So this is the tympanic isthmus, and then in a retrograde way, it can ventilate the Prusak space. When you have the tensor fold incomplete, open, the ventilation of the Prusak space comes directly from the supratubal recess. Now, we're going to remove the head of the malleus, and once you remove the head of the malleus, we have a very good view of the Prusak space, and also we have a very good view of the superior parts of the ear, so of the middle ear. So we have here the cog. The cog, in this case, is separated the anterior tympanic space from the posterior tympanic space, but sometimes the cog separates the supratubal recess from the anterior tympanic space. This is the tegmen of the middle ear, of the mastoid here. The middle fossa dura is in this position, and then when it goes to the anterior part, it descends here. So here the dura is very, very low near the supratubal recess and near the eustachian tube. So we can curette a little bit more here, just to expose a little bit. And look, we did not curette very much. We just curetted a little bit, just to demonstrate how can we see with this wide-angle view of the endoscope. We can see the lateral semicircular canal, adus ad antrum, posterior tympanic space, anterior tympanic space, supratubal recess over there, tympanic segment of the facial nerve, geniculate ganglia over here, a lateral semicircular canal, cochleariform process, canal of the muscle, the tensor tympani muscle. This is the supratubal recess, protympanic space here, promontory of the cochlea, ponticulus, subiculum, sinus tympani, finiculus, sinus subtympanicum, anterior sinus in this region here. So facial recess. So just elevating a tympanometal flap with a small curettage of the bone and removing the incus, you can see the anatomy that we can have. Most of the cholesteatoma disease, they have already eroded parts of the incus. So when you remove, when you deal with those cases, and when you remove the remaining parts of the incus, you get this anatomical view. And this is very important in order to orientate yourself during the surgery and in order to perform a very nice procedure with less invasive for your patient. So promontory of the cochlea here, ponticulus, subiculum, sinus tympani, the fustis here. Between the fustis and the finiculus, sometimes you can have this canaliculus here, or this tunnel that goes, when you have a pneumatized petrous apex, you can go all the way to the petrous apex. So you can have a route between the middle ear and the petrous apex whenever you have a pneumatized petrous apex. When you don't have a pneumatized petrous apex, of course, you don't have this open route between these structures here. This canal, when it's present, we call the canaliculus subcochlear. And here we have the protympanic, the protympanum, the protympanic space. The protympanic space, you have the eustachian tube, the carotid artery, and this structure here, which is called the protiniculus. So the protiniculus divides the protympanic space, the opening of the eustachian tube, to the hypotympanic air cells. So protiniculus here, carotid here, eustachian tube over there, and the canal of the muscle of the tensor tympani. Jacobson nerve is going to be in this position, supratubal recess, hypotympanic cells here, jugular is going to be in this position here, and the carotid here. So jugular, carotid, hypotympanum, promontory of the cochlea, anterior pillar, posterior pillar, tegmen of the round window, canaliculus subcochlear, fustis here, ponticulus, subiculum, finiculum, sinus tympani, sinus subtympanicum here, anterior sinus, cochleariform process, canal of the muscle, supratubal recess, region of the tensor fold here, the cog that separates the anterior tympanic space from the posterior tympanic space, lateral semicircular canal over here, adus ad antrum and antrum of the mastoid, facial recess, pyramidal amniocens, stapedius tendon, posterior crus, anterior crus, and then sinus tympani in all its glory here. So you can have a whole 360-degree view of the anatomy of the middle ear using an endoscope, just elevating a tympanometal flap with a small curettage sometimes, and the removal of the incos in this case, and the head of the malleus in this case, just to open more your views and your eyes during this dissection. Sometimes we can use a drill instead of a curette. And we are going to demonstrate the use of a drill in a second in order to give you some tips when you drill. First of all, you don't need a cutting bar. If you have a cutting bar, oh, yes, okay, good. But you do need one, two bars. We use usually a diamond burr with a 2 millimeter of diameter. Diamond burr, which is more safe than the cutting burr, and you don't have a lot of bone to remove. And 2 millimeters, which is the size, very, very nice. This burr doesn't have a protective shaft here, so you have to be careful about not injuring or not hitting your endoscope, your tip of the endoscope or the cable of the endoscope with the burr or with the shaft. So when you drill the temporal bone, when you do a mastoidectomy, you need to use a high-speed drill, 80,000 RPMs or a little bit less or a little bit more, in order to do the mastoidectomy. When you drill in the middle ear during endoscopic ear surgery, you don't need a high-speed drill. You need 5,000 or 10,000 RPMs. Why? Because first of all, it's not a lot of bone that you're going to remove. And second of all, when you have a high-speed drill, a lot of bone dust, a lot of smoke is going to fog the view of the endoscope, and then you're not going to be able to see anything. Now we are using 5,000 RPMs, and as you can see, we can have a bone removal. You can wash a little bit with saline solution. Your assistant has to put the aspirator, the suction device, near the external auditory canal. It doesn't need to go inside, and then you can see there are some smoke, but you can see there is some smoke, but you can see the region that you are drilling using this low speed setting. When you use a high speed drill here, 80,000 RPMs, there will be a lot of bone dust, and then thus you're not going to be able to see very well when you do this very big. See, now we are using with 80,000. So I think it was this, the dissection of the middle ear. I hope you have enjoyed the dissection of the middle ear. There are more movies at this channel, and I think I thank you very much for watching. And if you have questions, I'll be nice to answer using the email. So thank you very much for your time, and I hope that you see other videos on this YouTube channel. Thank you.